evening, everybody. A very warm welcome to St. Thomas's Church this morning. Lovely to see you on this bright and sunny day. After our service today, we're going to spend some time together in the park. So I don't know if you've brought a little picnic, if you've seen any of the messages. If you have, that's fab. If you haven't and you want to just grab something quickly and come and just spend some time together, just as a church family, just out there, we'll find a shady tree and we'll just sit under it. We've got some games and stuff. So please do join us after the service for our little informal picnic. This is our last ever 10:30 all-age service. Because you'll see in your pews, you've got a little flyer for what's coming next. So from September, we're going to be having two services every week. At 10:30, there'll be a traditional choral service every single week. So the second Sunday won't have this service anymore. This service will now be at 4:30 on the second Sunday of the month. And at 4:30 every other week, there will be a contemporary service with Sunday Club. So Sunday Club will be running every 10:30, every single week at 10:30 for the children who come there. And it will also be running every week at 4:30, except for the second Sunday of the month when this will be on. It's quite a complicated thing to get your head around this, I think. And also there is a dinner available for children after the 4:30 every week from September. Our first service is the 11th of September. I would love it if you were happy to bring these flyers home with you and to give them to somebody, to invite them to church to support our 4:30 service starting on the 11th of September every single week from then on. Would you please bring these home and think, who can I give this to? Who can I invite to support our new service? Thank you very much. Shall we pray as we begin our service this morning? Heavenly Father, we thank you for summer, for sunny days, for enjoying sunny time together. Lord, bless our picnic later on as we just get to know each other. And Lord, be with us in our worship this morning as we come to praise you. We thank you for all your blessings to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we stand and sing our first song? Sorry for the things that we have done wrong this week.
So could you please think of something that's happened this week that you said or you thought about somebody else that wasn't very kind? I'll give you a moment to think of that. Think of something you said or thought that wasn't kind. And if you've got something, and if you're sorry for that, could you hold your hands out? And could you make the sign of a cross in your right hand to show that God forgives you for that? Brilliant. Can you think now of a time when maybe you haven't been grateful, or maybe you haven't said thank you for something good that's happened to you this week? Give me a moment to think of that. Something that you weren't grateful for, or something that you didn't say thank you to God for. So it could just be something ordinary in your life, maybe food or family or your home. And could you just place your hands out again and just make the sign of the cross in your other hand, in the palm of your other hand, to show that God forgives you. And finally, can you think of a time when somebody else has said or done something to you that's hurt you? And as you do that, can you make some fists? Somebody else has said or done something to you that's hurt you. And if you're ready to forgive that person for what they've done to you, can you just open your hands to symbolize letting go of the thing that's happened to you, and that you're ready to receive God's love again for you? And if we have an insight, let's say together, thank you, God, that you love us and you forgive us when we get things wrong. Amen. Brilliant. Thank you so much. Now, it's time to witness Garstang's very first ever marathon. We've got some amazing marathon runners, and I think that they've been going for quite a long time this morning. The race set off at 8 a.m. this morning, and I've got a feeling that any moment now we're going to see our first runner just beginning to charge up into church. We'll see our first runner, maybe. Our first runner is very young and very small, no plateaus in this church. Our first runner is William Kelly. Our first runner is taking a turn off. Our first runner seems to have got confused. And at the earliest opportunity, has went straight and sat down. What a shame our first runner didn't manage to finish the race. But look, here now comes another runner.
That silly man dresses a beetroot knocked me over back there. He made me twist my ankle.
It looks like this runner's hurt. I hope they can get some help.
I can't carry on. This is too painful. I'll have to drop out of the race. And it's all Mr. Beetroot's fault. I hate him.
What a shame that this runner too has dropped out of the race, literally metres from the finish line. Surely she could have kept going, but no. With any number of doctors here in the congregation too. I thought that was quite good, Dad. But wait, here comes another runner just coming into the line. Goodness me, what is that runner carrying? He seems to have a very heavy rucksack on his back. What an unusual thing to have during a marathon. No problems in this church at all. What will he do?
This backpack is far too heavy for me. I'm going to have to sit down here.
I wonder why he doesn't just take the backpack off. That would have made more sense, wouldn't it? That's really strange. But what's this? Look at how focused he is on the prize. I think he's going to be the winner of the first Garstang Marathon.
I've won. I've won the prize that I've my eye on all through this race.
Well done. Go and have a seat again. Well done. Give him a round of applause.
The Bible tells us that one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining on towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus Christ. Thank you so much to our fantastic actors for taking part in our drama this morning. If I could just grab the mic. And if we could have our next slide, please. I think it's a... Oh, I am so sorry I forgot the song. My mistake. I'm very sorry. Shall we stand and sing? We were going to have a Bible reading next, but let's do our next song. Please forgive me, band.
Epistle to the Hebrews, chapter 12, beginning at the first verse. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Shall we pray? So Heavenly Father, send your Holy Spirit among us today. Be our teacher. Help us to run the race that you have set before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So in our reading here today from Hebrews, we've heard that the Christian life is like a race
And that's why earlier on we had Charlie and Freya and Raffi and also Davis, somebody else, taking part in a fantastic drama, which was like a race, the first Garstang marathon. And they faced challenges. Some of them took wrong turns, like Charlie did. Some of them faced dastardly beatroots. Some of them were carrying some heavy baggage on their way, and many of them didn't manage to finish the race. They were running the race, but some of them didn't persevere, and some of them stopped the race instead. For Charlie, what Charlie faced was the hindrance of distraction. He got distracted halfway up by seeing his sister in the queue beside him, and he turned off instead of finishing the race, and he did really well, Charlie. Well done. For Freya, she faced the hindrance of suffering. She too could see the prize that was at the end of the race up here, but alas, she was suffering to her granddad, and so she didn't persevere in the race either, and she didn't finish. For David, he faced the hindrance of carrying some heavy baggage on the way, which weighed him down, and eventually it became too much just near the end, and he sat down. And didn't persevere and finish the race either. Only the mighty Raffi finished and continued to the end of the race and laid his hands on this magnificent prize. There are many things in life, aren't there, that might slow us down or cause us to even stop in the race of faith. There are so many hindrances, so many wounds that we might have suffered in our life, so many sins that can entangle us and stop us from running the race as Jesus would have us do. I wonder what those things might be for you. What things slow you down on your race? Can I give us a moment just in quiet to think about that question? What things might slow you down in your faith and how you live out what you believe? I'll give us just a moment to think about that. Well, it's different for different people, I think. Everybody's got their own things. And it's also a really difficult question. Sometimes it's very painful to think about that question too deeply. If it's a sin that entangles us, that is the ways in which we don't love God with all our strength and mind and soul and heart, if it's one of those, and those ways that we don't love our neighbour as ourselves, if that's something that entangles us, usually those things are quite deeply rooted in our lives and quite difficult actually to extricate ourselves from. If we take prayer as an example, prayer is part of the Christian race. Perhaps our daily routine might contain actually very little space for prayer. Perhaps for good reasons, maybe by the time we've gone to work and come home and cooked the tea and done washing and done the 100 other things that seem to be demanding our attention, we might find that we don't actually have very much space left in the day for prayer. Which, after all, nobody ever knows if we said prayers or not. Those around us, I mean, don't know. The Christian race may also be one of listening to God's words to us, primarily in the words of the Bible. And yet that too can be quite difficult. If we make time to read the Bible, we might find it full of very obtuse stories that are thousands of years old, and we might find that it speaks about things that don't directly answer the questions that we actually have of the text. And so the race in this case might seem too tiring to continue on with, too difficult, and we might find ourselves, like David, just carrying it on and then going, oh, actually, it's just too heavy that I'm going to set it down. Perhaps the most difficult one, yes. The Christian race is also one of a deeper conversion of heart. What do I mean by that? I mean, the Christian race is one of continually opening ourselves and being changed into greater and greater love and generosity towards others. Continually opening ourselves to those around us, whether or not they might actually help us or harm us, opening ourselves to those around us. Now, this is a really difficult aspect of Christian life, this invitation of deeper conversion to our hearts, because often it requires us to face up to our own imperfections and to ask for God's grace to soften our hearts towards the needs of others. Now, these are not the only aspects of a Christian race, prayer and listening to God and inviting deeper conversion into our lives. But already these things challenge our perseverance to the very core. If you think about your Christian race, putting these blocks in, it's not always easy. What to do? Well, Hebrews goes on to say, fix your eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. The man who faced persecution and suffering for doing good, and yet opened himself to everybody, including those who crucified him. Our eyes must go to him when we don't know the way. When our questions seem too large and we feel like giving up and stopping the race. When our life just seems that bit too difficult to keep going on. When other things crowd into our life and it seems too full to continue this race of faith. Maybe when we're angry and it feels too costly not to bite back at whoever has offended us or hurt us. In exactly those moments, we must lift our eyes to Jesus and to trust in him as we keep racing on in this race with great perseverance. And so can I challenge you today, if you're under 11, if you're under 11 and you're still at primary school, can I challenge you to keep running the race of faith? It will be hard sometimes, and you might find that sometimes you don't much feel like keeping going. Many find, especially after they get confirmed and go off to secondary school, that it's hard to keep that race going. Just like Charlie found it hard to keep the race going, there's many things that distract us and we may feel like sitting down. Can I challenge you, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. If you're over 11, perhaps you're an adult, I challenge you to keep running the race through your life too. Other things might grab your attention, life is busy. There are good things and bad things that might distract us from the race. And faith might seem like the least urgent of many pressing concerns. You might just, like David, want to sit down because there's just too much stuff in my bag. I challenge you, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Or perhaps you're full of questions and full of healing. Maybe life has dealt you a really hard hand at the moment. Or maybe it's always that you are in hard hands. You might, like Freya, feel unable to keep going, maybe because of an injury that somebody has caused to you. If that's you, maybe speak to somebody about that. And I challenge you too to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, even in the pain. We're going to hear from the scriptures again now, and we're going to hear a challenging story from Luke's Gospel about the division and separation that truly persevering on this race of faith can bring. Just like fans of football teams are divided, and I'm sorry, United fans, about what happened yesterday, truly I am. But if we persevere and follow Jesus and are on his team, then maybe we can expect to face some opposition sometimes in our lives. Would you please stand for our Gospel reading? Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided. Father against son, and son against father. Mother against daughter, and daughter against mother. Mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He said to the crowds also, When you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say it's going to rain, and so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say there will be scorching heat, and it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
As we remain standing, we say together the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So please do take your seats again as we pray.
So let us pray. We place into the hands of God the life of this church, our new 4:30 p.m. congregation starting next month, the people sitting around us, and those who are not with us today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into the hands of God all our difficulties and frustrations, all our hopes and worries about the future. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into the hands of God a world that needs peace, a world that needs wisdom, a world that needs healing. We pray especially for the war in Ukraine, praying for peace and for protection for the people. Show us how we can love and support our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine in the best ways. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into the hands of God the leaders of our own and every nation, the poor of our own and every land, those who live in fear, and all who hold the lives of others in their hands. Loving God, you have poured such love into the world. Show us how to make it a more loving place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into the hands of God our families, our friends, and our neighbours. All those who live and work in Garstang, in our shops and local businesses, those who work from home and those who are unemployed, and all those who pass through the town on their travels. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into the hands of God all those we know who are suffering, and in a moment of quiet, we name anybody we would like to before God now. Loving God, would you bless them with your love and comfort and healing, and show us how to care for them. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. We're going to sing again now, I'm accepted, I'm forgiven. If you're able, please would you stand.
microphone just needs to do walkies again. We come now to celebrate the meaning and gather, which is the meal that Jesus gave to his disciples, to command us to continue this memory each week until his coming again in glory. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Why is it right to give thanks and praise?
Listen, we will hear.
Lord of all life, you created the universe for all living things to reflect your glory. You give us this great and beautiful earth to discover and to cherish. You give us your love, even when things go wrong. Jesus, you hurt and pain. Through him you wipe away our tears and fill us with your peace. You made us all, each wonderfully different, to join with the angels and sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We thank you, loving Father, because when we turned away, you sent Jesus your Son. He gave his life for us on the cross and shows us the way to live. Send your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us Christ's body and blood.
Why do we share his bread and wine?
Listen, we will hear.
On the night before he died, when darkness had fallen, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this to remember me." After they had eaten, he took a cup of wine, gave thanks, and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my blood, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins." And so, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate his love, his death, and his risen life. As you feed us with these gifts, send your Holy Spirit and change us more and more to be like Jesus, our Savior.
How do we follow Jesus Christ?
Listen, we will hear.
Help us, Father, to love one another. And as we look forward to that day when suffering is ended, and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. And now, with St. Thomas and all your saints, we give you glory through Jesus Christ in the strength of the Spirit, today and forever. Please be good to seek again, and as our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. So draw near with you. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you. And feed him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you. God. We thank thee for being with us, with the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we are freed from our souls and bodies, to be living in sacrifice. Send us out in the power of our spirits, to live and work to your grace and glory. Amen.
So let's stand and sing our final song, Lord, after that.
Peace, love, and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.